Good morning to all of you. So let us start the next chapter, which is basically random processes. Here in the slide, you can see that I have used the words random and stochastic. So both are same words. We can call random process as stochastic process also, or a stochastic process is also a random process, right? This topic is very important in the context that there is a term which is known as random variable, and there is another term which is known as random process. So you must understand the difference between the random variable and a random process. Random variable we have already studied in our previous 6 weeks. Right. And now let us look at random process. Though I have covered these topics earlier also, but I will, revise the topics and also discuss additionally about the questions in the tute sheet that I have given in tute sheet number 7. So what is the random process? For example, xt is a signal which is defined as a cos omega t plus phi. Let's say omega is fixed. We treat omega as constant, and also a, which is the amplitude, and phi are also constants. That means if I tell you to plot the signal for a equal to five, and let's say phi equal to zero, so you can easily plot the cosine signal. Let's say if I tell you a is equal to five and phi is equal to pi by four, then you will just phase shift the signal. All right. So that means once you know a, I'm treating omega as fixed, right? I'm worrying about a and phi, let's say, and I am also treating a and phi as constants. For one time, I will treat a as constant and phi also as constant. That means I can plot the signal. Once a is given, once I know omega, once I know phi, I can plot the signal. Right. So therefore, this type of signal is known as a deterministic signal. So if I ask you to plot it, if you know the value at what particular point t you want to find out the value of the signal, you can find the signal value. So this signal is known as a deterministic signal. Right. And I'm treating a and phi both as random variables. In the next case, in the first case, I treated a and phi as constants. That means if a and phi are constants, it is a deterministic signal. If I tell you the value of phi, if I tell you the value of a, you can plot the signal. And then if I want to know the value of the signal at a particular time, then I can find out the value. So therefore, this type of signal where in this particular example, when a is fixed, phi is fixed, it is a deterministic signal. But let us say either a or phi or both are random variables, right? They are not constants. In that case, if a is variable, phi is variable, or both are variable, we cannot draw or represent the signal, right? So there will be many realizations depending on the values these variables can take. There will be many realizations. That is, we have to show many waveforms to show the possible signal set. All right. So you must understand, we are talking about a deterministic signal and a random signal. Random signal means which you cannot draw. Once a or phi or both are random variables, you cannot draw the signal. There can be many possible realizations of the signal. Then infinite waveforms are possible if A varies continuously or phi varies continuously. Now let us say that A has two values. Let's say that A is a Bernoulli's random variable. That means it has got two values. So A has got two values, right? A is a Bernoulli and phi is zero. Phi is fixed, but A is a random variable, which is a Bernoulli's random variable that has got only two values. A can take two values. So that means there are two realizations of this signal. One is x1t, the other is, because A is a random variable, so it has one value is, let's say the sample space is 1 and 2, one value corresponds to x1t with amplitude as 1, x2t with amplitude as 2. That means two realizations are there, right? But at one particular point of time, let's say t1, how many values are possible? Two values are possible. We cannot predict the value here. We cannot predict the value. So at t1, there will be, since A is a random variable, A can have, and I am taking the case of Bernoulli's random variable, where A can have two values. At particular time t1, two values are possible. So at this time t1, this signal xt becomes xt1 is a random variable. At t1, it becomes a random variable. Though this is a case of two values only, but there can be a case of multiple values, right? So it becomes at t1, it becomes a random variable. At t2, it becomes another random variable. Let's see what I'm trying to say. I will explain. Because of randomness created by random variable A, if we know the probability, now there are two, values of A, so two realizations are possible. One is this, one is this. At one particular point, t1, it will have two values, but we cannot predict the value, right? Which value is there? So it can have two values, correct? So at t1, two values are possible. At t2, again, two values are possible. At t3, again, two values are possible. So xt1 is one random variable. xt2 is another random variable. xt3 is another random variable. Now, what is the random process? Random process is a set of all these random variables. Let me explain you once again. Now, because of the randomness created by random variable A, right? Now, if we know the probability distribution of the outcomes, we can find the expected value. Here, I was saying that we cannot find out the exact value. But if we know the probability of this value or the probability of this value, then we can find the expected value. But we cannot find the actual value. All right. Now, this is a random process. So let me explain in words what is a random variable. I started from this signal, A cos omega t plus phi. Forget about omega for the time being. Consider A and phi. And I am assuming A is constant, phi is constant. Now, once A is constant, phi is constant, omega we already know, we can plot the signal. Once the values of A and phi are given, we can plot the signal. At any particular point of time, right, I can find out the value of this signal. So therefore, this signal is a deterministic signal. But if A or phi or both are random variables, that means A, phi or both can take multiple values, right? Then there are many realizations possible. Here in this case, when A is 5, phi is 0, one realization is possible. When A is 5, phi is 5 by 4, another realization is only one realization is possible. But when A, phi, or both are random variables, multiple realizations are possible. Now, let us take the case when phi is a constant, phi is 0, and A is a Bernoulli's random variable. That means it takes values 1 and 2. That means only two values A can have. Phi is constant. So therefore, two realizations are possible. One is this realization, another is this realization drawn. At a particular time t1, two values are possible. So it becomes, xt becomes a random variable. xt1 becomes a random variable because it can have two values. Another time t2, so therefore xt2 becomes another random variable. And this becomes a random process. What is a random process? Random process is a set of random variables, right? Now, the random process has two realizations, so that's already done. Now, how to specify? I will define the random process once I finish with the specifications and the basics. Then I will try to define the random process once again. Now let's take a sample of random process xt. Taking the sample means at particular time t1, take the values of the random process xt. So if it is time t1, it will be xt1. So I will denote the random process as xt, right? At t1, it will be one random variable. At t2, it will be another random variable. So xt1, xt2, x3, xt3 will be different set of random variables. And what is a random process? Random process is a collection of these random variables. Now let's take a sample of random process xt at time t equal to t1. We get another random variable. So a random process is a non-countable infinity of random variables, one for each t. This is very important. I was saying for t1, you will have a set of random variables. At t2, you will have another set of random variables, another set of another random variable. So a random process is a non-countable infinity of random variables for each t. For a specific t, xt is a random variable for a specific t. For a specific t means for t1, t2, t3, and so on. Xt will be, at that time, will be a random variable with some probability distribution. Probability distribution means as there are two values possible. So what is the probability of this occurrence of this value and what is the probability of occurrence of this value? So two values, two possible probabilities associated with the outcomes. But if the values are more, there will be more probability. So it will be a complete probability distribution. So xt is a random variable with the distribution fxt, xt is less than or equal to x, right? The function depends on t and it consists of all the probabilities of the event so that the event is less than or equal to x for all outcomes such that at specific time, samples of the random process do not exceed this value x. So this is capital Fxt is the probability distribution, right? And one more term we have to define, which is the probability, which is the density function. And therefore the distribution at time t1 of the random process xt is f of subscript xt1. In the argument as x1 t1 equal to probability xt1 less than equal to x1. This is how we define the probability distribution at t1. The probability density function, how do we define? It is the derivative of this probability distribution. Now, let us take another sample of this random process xt at time t2. Now it will be, what is the distribution? F subscript x2t, x2 comma t2, probability xt2 less than or equal to x2. And what is the density function? This is how we can define the density function. So the point that I'm trying to say is that any random process, right, is a, at different times, you will have multiple values. So it is a random variable. Another time, it will have different values, another random variable. So random process is a collection of, you know, random variables with probability. Each random variable will have a probability distribution associated, which is denoted by capital F. And there will also be a probability density function associated, which is denoted by small f, which is actually the curl derivative of the probability distribution. So this is one way of defining the random process. Another way is to define the moments of the random process. We'll see the moments part. Now, a random process xt whose distribution or density function, now this is very important. This is related to your TUT questions. And you will find these questions in your exam also from here. A random process xt whose distribution is denoted by capital F subscript xt of x comma t, or density function denoted by small f. Density function is the derivative of the distribution function. A random process xt does, if it does not change with time, right? A random process xt whose distribution does not change with time. This is called strictly stationary random process. But these type of random, we want these type of random processes so that the probability distribution does not change with time. But in reality, this does not happen. So we make the assumption in a random process that the probability distribution remains constant or for some amount of time. So one term we have identified is strictly stationary random process. What is a strictly stationary random process? Where the probability distribution function or the density function does not change with time. Now, another variation, a random process can be, okay, let me come to the another variation. This is about the moments. I will come to the moments a little later. Yeah, I want to put more stress on this. This SSS means strictly stationary stochastic process, triple S process. Density functions of random variables are invariant with time. They do not change with time. This is not a strictly stationary stochastic process. And because, as I said, practically these are not possible. So we define wide sense stationary process. Now, what is the meaning of wide sense stationary process? As I said, for some particular amount of time, we will say that the process is stationary. How to prove that? This is very important. You need not to, go into the proofs of this these rules, but you must remember these rules. Strictly stationary process, invariant with time. If you are able to, if I give you any random process with any type of signal, right, any equation, now what you need to prove there? If the density functions are invariant with time, if you prove that it is a strictly stationary random process, we'll take examples. Now, if it is a wide sense stationary process, then what you will do? If XT is a wide sense stationary process, you will have to say that its mean is constant, that you have to prove, and the autocorrelation function, right? Autocorrelation function, what is autocorrelation function? I will discuss more about the autocorrelation function in the coming slides. I will explain the physical meaning of these autocorrelation functions. But let me quickly define these rules. I will come back to the explanation of the autocorrelation function once again. Let's say RXT, in the subscript, there is X, which is related to the random process, RXT1, T2, at different two different times. If we are able to prove that this autocorrelation function is equal to difference of the two times rather than individual times, then we can say that it is a wide sense stationary. If we prove these two rules, we can say that it is a wide sense stationary process. Now, if this is one process I'm talking, which is XT. Now, let's say if there are two processes, if XT and YT are jointly, when we can prove that jointly these are two wide sense stationary processes, then we will have to prove the mean of X is constant, mean of Y is constant. That's number one. And we also need to prove that cross correlation, RXY, earlier I wrote RX because there was only one process. But here are two processes, RXY, T1, T2 should be equal to the expected value of XT1 into YT1. And this should be equal to the cross correlation. This is not autocorrelation. Autocorrelation is between the same process at different times. But cross correlation is between two processes at two different times. I will explain. I will come back to these definitions once again. And autocovariance function is defined as the autocorrelation function minus the product of the means. Right. Now, if the autocorrelation, if the cross correlation function is zero, then we can say that the autocorrelation function is the product of the means, because this will become zero and this autocorrelation will be the product of the means. And what is cross covariance? Cross covariance is defined as CXY T1 comma T2. Cross correlation minus the product of the mean. Let me now explain these terms. what is mean value, what is autocorrelation, what is cross correlation. So first, because you in solving these questions, you will have to find out the mean also. Now, how to find out the mean? For example, this is the XT. This is the random process, and its variation is with respect to time. So this graph, this haphazard graph is for the random process. What is the mean value? Mean value of this random process, X bar can be found out. Limit capital T approaches zero, right? Within the frame of time where you want to analyze this signal, limit T approaches infinity, 1 over T, 0 to capital T, XT dt. That means it gives the area under the curve within this time period. Now, the mean value, X bar, is the height of the rectangular area. Please remember, please understand this definition. What is mean value basically? You draw a line, because this is a random signal, random process. Now, this is you draw a line, which is basically the average of these values. Now, this becomes a rectangle. The mean value X bar is the height of the rectangular area and having the same area as under the function XT. Now, this will be a rectangular. Now, this white line is basically forming a rectangle. Area under the area in the rectangle is basically equal to the area under this haphazard kind of curve. Right, so that is the mean of the random process. Can also be defined as the first moment of the PDF, the probability density function. Now, what is mean square value? If you take the square of the mean, I have given you the formula, how to calculate the mean square value. How to calculate the variance? Variance is the sigma is defined as sigma x square. X is the random process. Xt for different times minus x bar is the mean. So what is variance? What is the variance? Why variance is important? Now, average of the square of the deviation of XT from the mean value. So what is the deviation of the XT, which is a random process, from the mean value? We square it, right? That is known as the variance. If we take the under root also, that is known as the standard deviation. So it basically gives us the deviation of the random process XT from the mean value. What is autocorrelation? The autocorrelation is also known as the autocovariance. What it describes? Now, this is the random process XT, along x-axis is time, and this is capital T. This time period, at this point and at this point, this difference is tau. And this point is, let's say, T1, this point is T2. T1 minus T2 is tau. The autocorrelation or the autocovariance describes the general dependency of XT with its value at a short time later. So how, now the value here is, let's say, XT. What is the, dependency at some time T plus tau? So it will, the autocorrelation value will give us that. XT, how it is dependent on XT plus tau, that is autocorrelation. In the same process, the autocorrelation describes the general dependency of XT with its value at a short time interval. Now, how it is to be calculated? This autocorrelation is calculated as integral 0 to T, XT minus X bar, XT plus tau minus X bar. Right? The value of rho X tau at, when tau is 0, that means when tau is 0 at the same time, it is known as the variance. Basically, so it is known as the variance because we are trying to calculate the square of this. When tau is zero, it is the variance. And there is one more important parameter which you must understand, the normalized autocorrelation. The autocorrelation function is rho x tau, which is given by this. When it is normalized with the variance, square of the variance, that means the variance, not the square. Sigma x is the standard deviation. Sigma x square is the variance. When the autocorrelation is normalized with the variance, this is known as normalized autocorrelation. And when tau equal to zero, this has to be equal to one because the autocorrelation in that case will become the variance. That's what I have said. So what I have tried to explain here is are the different parameters which you need to calculate while proving that a random process is a strictly stationary random process or a wide sense stationary random process, right? So these are various parameters based on which you actually characterize or specify a random process. This is autocorrelation. Now, this is autocorrelation for a random process eventually decays to zero at large term. The autocorrelation for a sinusoidal process is a cosine function which does not decay to zero. These are some characteristics of the autocorrelation function. There is another important function, another important property which needs to be described, which is known as the spectral density, or what we call as the power spectral density. The spectral density or autospectral density or power spectral density or spectrum, same words. I mean, same words for the words for the same quantity, describes the average frequency content of a random process XT. Now, basic relation. Now, this sigma basic relationship between variance and the spectral density is defined as sigma X square is equal to integral 0 to infinity, the spectral density dn, right? The quantity S of x and dot into delta n represents the contribution to sigma x square to this variance from the frequency increment, because this is variance of the variance present in the overall signal. Signal consists of various frequencies. Now, what is the contribution of individual frequencies to the variance of variance, which represents the distribution of that signal in terms of frequency? So it will give you that the quantity Sn dot n represents the contribution to sigma x square from the frequency increment delta n. So that is power spectral density. This is the relationship how to calculate the power spectral density. Sxn is limit t approaches infinity t by 2 mod of this xtn whole square, xtn mod square, where xtn is the Fourier transform of the process xt. Probably you might not have studied Fourier transform, but Fourier transform will actually give you the frequency analysis of a particular process taken over the time minus t by 2 to plus t by 2. The above relationship is the basis of the usual method of obtaining the spectral density of the experimental data. We can apply a more faster algorithm, a fast Fourier FFT technique. You need not to worry about these things. So this is spectral density relationship with the autocorrelation function. Spectral density is twice the Fourier transform. Right? So this is the inverse relationship. You need to keep these relationships and remember these relationships while proving the properties in the questions. Now, what is cross-correlation? Autocorrelation is with respect to the same process. Cross-correlation is with respect to the two processes, XT and YT, right? So this is tau, and this is X bar, the mean of the first process. Y bar is the mean of the second process. Now, what is cross-correlation? Cross-correlation function describes the general dependency of XT with another random process, but with a slight change in time, YT plus tau, delayed by a time tau. So this is cross correlation, Cxy tau equal to, this is the formula to calculate the cross correlation. And covariance, the covariance is the cross correlation function with time with tau equal to zero. Here in this cross correlation, if you put tau equal to zero, you will get the covariance. Very important characteristics, you know, you must know while solving the questions. And you will remember when you take up any course on data sciences, machine learning, DSP, and any other course. You know, these things are very important. And this is the cross-correlation coefficient. This is defined as X prime. The cross-correlation, this X prime is basically the you please note that X prime and Y prime are used to denote the fluctuating parts of XT from the means subtracted, right? So you must remember the X prime T, Y prime T, divided by rho x dot rho y, which is the standard deviation. If you want to put it here, the variance, then you will have to take the under root, right? So where x and y are identical to each other, with the value rho is plus 1. When they are identical, it is plus 1. When yt is equal to minus xt, the value is minus 1. So the cross-correlation coefficient will vary from minus 1 to plus 1. That's the variation of the cross-correlation coefficient. Right? This is cross-spectral density. Another important definition which you must remember, I have given the formula here. Please look at this formula. Normalized co-spectral density also, right? So okay, these are the rules. These rules are very important for solving your tube sheet number 7. As I said, I described you the process, strictly stationary process. I described the Whiteson stationary. Now, a random process FT is said to be a strictly stationary process if its statistics, the probability density functions of the different random variables are invariant to a shift tau. That means invariant in time, right? That is, the two processes FT and FT plus tau have the same PDFs. That's the point. Now, let me just, you know, skip these. I will come to the rules in my return slide. Okay, so what is the random process? I have already described. This is another example I have explained. Actually, I described these the random process in my previous lecture using a telephone call. For example, you get a telephone call and this is the signal you are you are measuring. From another call, you are measuring this signal, right? At a particular time t1, What were the variations in the signal amplitude? So this becomes a random variable. At another time t2, what were the variations in the signal amplitude? That becomes another random variable. So what I mean to say is that a random process is a collection of time functions with associated probability description. The same thing as I just tried to explain. I have already covered this part, right? So if you know, look at the, let me just describe the rules, okay, some of the rules, and let me do one or two examples here only. Okay, let's talk about the second order. These are the rules written. Okay, let's look at this rule, right? A random process XT is said to be Whiteson stationary process if and only if its mean is constant and its autocorrelation function depends on only difference of the time, not the individual times. That's the point. Tau equal to t1 minus t2. The autocorrelation function depends on the difference in the time rather than the absolute value of the time. That means autocorrelation function is actually given by xt plus tau xt, but it is not dependent on these individuals. This is t1, let's say this is t2, but it will depend on t1 minus t2. The autocorrelation function, which is defined as expected value of these two random processes, but actually it is the RT1 minus tau, right? So let us look at one example if I have here. Okay, I have this example. I think this example is there in your tube sheet also. The example says that phi 1 is equal to 0 is a necessary condition for the random process. Now, what is the random process given? Random process given is Ft equal to sine lambda t plus theta. So this is my random process given, where lambda is a constant. So in this random process, lambda is assumed to be constant and theta is a random variable. So once theta is a random variable, that means many realizations of this equation are possible. So if many realizations are possible, you cannot predict the value at a particular time t1. So at a particular time t1, there will be various values of this ft. So that means add ft1, that means ft1 will become a random variable. In the same way, ft2 will also become a random variable. So what is a random process? Random process is a collection of random variables. So therefore, ft is a random process where theta is a random variable, right? Now, whose characteristic function of a random variable? This random variable is given by phi s equal to e to expected value of e j s theta. We can also write this as expected value of cos of s theta plus j expected value of sine of s theta, because e to the power x is equal to cos x plus j sine x. We can write it like that. We want to know what we want to prove. We want to prove that this is the necessary condition, phi 1 equal to 0. Phi of s is given, which is the characteristic function. We want to prove that for s equal to 1, this is 0. Is a necessary condition. Necessary condition for the random process, this is the random process. For this random process to be wide sense stationary. Please try to understand the question. The question is that this is the random process. We want to prove that this random process is a wide sense stationary random process. And what is the necessary condition? Necessary condition is phi 1 should be equal to 0. What is phi of s? Phi of s is this characteristic function given. Now let's try to look at this solution. As I said, for ft to be only stationary, it has to be ft to be stationary in the wide sense. So apply the rules. The first rule says that its expected value must be independent of time. Of course, it has to be independent of time and it has to be constant. Right? Expected value of this random process has to be constant. Now, we try to solve it. Expected value of this random process, what is the random process? Sine lambda t plus t theta. E of sine, just expand this function. We can say that sine, because only theta is a random variable if you look at. So I can, we expanded this function like sine a plus b, and it is sine a cos b plus cos a sine b, right? Sine of lambda t is independent of theta. Theta is a random variable. So we can take it out from the expected value. And similarly, we can take the cos lambda t out of this expected value of sine theta. Now, if ft is stationary, the equation will be equal to a constant. This is possible. That means for it to be wide sense stationary, first of all, stationary, that means it has to be independent of time. If it is stationary, it is independent of time. If it is wide sense stationary, its mean has to be constant. If it is stationary, then it has to be independent of the time. If ft is stationary, the equation will be equal to a constant. This has to be equal to a constant, the expected value of this random process. This is possible only when the coefficients sine of lambda t and cos lambda t are zero. Right? Then only this, if you multiply this, then these two can become zero. Only this is the possibility where this equation can be a constant. You can try it, no problem. So that means expected value of ft, so this has to be zero. Now, since what is phi s? Phi s is given to be e cos s theta plus. What is phi 1? Phi 1 will be e expected value of cos theta plus j sine theta. Expected value of cos theta plus j sine theta. We have already proved that expected value of cos theta is equal to expected value of sine theta equal to 0. So therefore, phi of 1 has to be 0 for this process, given process to be wide sense stationary. Right? So in this way, you, I have given what I have circulated the solutions to Harshita also. You can take the solutions from Harshita and do sheet number 7. I will do one group I have, but others can also see those answers. And you know, you can pursue what with those solutions, and you will appreciate. I have tried. I have some of the solutions I have written down with my with our handwritten. You know, so that you can appreciate the solution. So this is a, so we can say that if this FT is a random process, it is wide sensationally random process. Why? Because if it is, the question is that if it is a wide sensationally process, this is the necessary condition, and we have proved that. Similarly, you can solve the other questions also, right? And these are some necessary conditions. Repeatedly, I am giving you in the blue shaded slides also, and my handwritten slides are also, you can have a look into the ergodicity. As far as ergodicity is concerned, I will talk about ergodic random processes later, but just talk about the stationary, the strictly stationary and wide sense stationary random. Right, so these are the definitions of the we have in the previous lecture, I have also covered what is a Poisson process, right? So the you can look into my notes, but the most important thing in a Poisson process to be understood is that, right, let me explain it through an example. Suppose that, what is a Poisson distribution and what is a Poisson process? Suppose that Poisson random process, it is a random process, but it's a particular type of random process. This is Poisson random. Suppose that we can expect some independent event to occur lambda times over a specified time interval. Meaning by that, let's suppose that a particular we can expect some independent event is there, but it occurs, we expect. The point is that we expect. Actually, it is happening or not, that's a different story. But we expect that the independent event occurs lambda times over a specified time interval. How we can make an analogy for this? Let us say there is a fast food restaurant, and we can expect, as my first line says here, we can expect two customers every 3 minutes. Whether they are coming or not, that's a different story. But we expect in a fast food restaurant, two customers can come every 3 minutes on average. That is this lambda. The probability of exactly X occurrences, no, but what is, how many exactly occurs? How to calculate that probability? So try to understand a Poisson event, Poisson point. Suppose that we can expect some, we are expecting, and what actually is happening is defined by X. Expected is defined by lambda. So the probability of exactly X occurrences is equal to F of X colon lambda. And this probability of X occurrences, let's say 4 occurrences or 6 occurrences or 9 occurrences, right? And this is given by lambda raised to the power X, e to the power minus lambda x factorial. X is equal to number of occurrences of event in interval of length t, and lambda is the average number of occurrences. So I can explain this Poisson distribution quickly with the help of an example within the time available in this lecture. Suppose a fast food restaurant can expect two customers every 3 minutes. So in a fast food restaurant, the restaurant owner is expecting two customers every 3 minutes, expecting. So what is the value of lambda? We will see. What is the probability that 4 or fewer patrons, means customers, will enter the restaurant in a 9-minute period? So our time period is given to be 9 minutes, and we are expecting two customers every 3 minutes. That means in 9 minutes, how many we can expect? 6 customers we can expect. What is the value of lambda? is equal to 6. But what is the value of x? X, the value of x says that 4 or fewer. So we want to find out the probability associated here. So we want to find out the probability less than equal to 4. So what is that probability equal to? Probability that no customer comes, because it is less than equal to 4 or fewer. No customer come, probability that no customer come, probability that exactly one customer come, probability exactly 2, exactly 3, exactly 4 customers come. So this is the probability of 4 or fewer customers, the addition of these different probabilities. And this is given by the Poisson distribution, gives us this. We can calculate this based on the Poisson distribution formula. And this says that probability 4 or fewer, this is equal to probability 0 customers with average 6. Probability 1 customers with average 6. Probability 2 customers, that means x is 0, lambda is 6. X is 1, lambda is 6. X is 2, lambda is 6, and so on. So, and we know this formula, probability 0. X is 0, lambda is 6. What is the probability? We can use this formula. Lambda raised to the power x, e to the power minus lambda by x factor. So we can find out the different probabilities, and we come to know that it is 28.5% with 28.5% probability, this question can be solved. That probability of 4 or fewer customers visiting this fast food restaurant. So this is Poisson distribution. This is a Poisson process. We will look into the Poisson process, though I have already covered in my lectures before the sessional one. But still, I would like to go in detail, a little bit of detail of the Poisson process also, and Markov chain. Then we will start with the Markov chain. I started with the Markov chains earlier also, but I did not give any questions in due sheet, right? So this is known as this probability mass function of the probability distribution, and this is the probability mass. This is how we can find out the probability, the Poisson probability in a Poisson distribution. All right, so what I have covered in this lecture, I have covered a random process. What is a random process? What is the difference between a random variable and a random process? Defined random process in a comprehensive way. How to specify a random process, meaning by what is the mean, what is the variance, what is the autocorrelation function, what is the cross-correlation function of two jointly, we can also do of two different processes. Those are known as specifying a random process. And I have tried to solve one question, given a lot of questions in the due sheet also. Please try to solve this question. The information required to solve this question is available in the slides. All right. So I finished my lecture. If any questions are there, you're most welcome to ask. But if there are no questions, then I will finish the lecture. I will upload the recording also and the notes also on LM. Please go through notes. You can ask me any question anytime. I have told you the means through email, through phone, through Zoom meeting, any way you can contact. Thank you.